Good morning. Undoubtedly, I would like to apologize for the delay. But this indeed had given us an opportunity to meet each other and speak to each other, the panelists, I mean. And I feel that I am fortunate because I'm sitting with the researchers and the academics. We are proud of having them in the Arab world. I would like to thank the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies for convening this conference and for allocating the women's rights and social issues in Arab Gulf states. The title is splendid because the woman resembles the central plank of any society in any given country. We'd like to kick off the session. We've got three researchers. We've got three academics. Dr. Amal al-Malki. She needs no introduction, but she is an associate teaching professor of English at Carnegie Mellon University and the executive director of the Translation and Interpreting Institute. And she is the author of Arab Women in Arab News, Old Stereotypes and New Media. Al-Maliki holds a PhD in Comparative Literature from the University of London. The lady will be talking about the citizenship rights and women. You've got 15 minutes.
It's a pleasure to be presenting this year's conference. I'll be presenting in English, I need to warn you, given that the paper I'm working on is written in English and is a part of a bigger project. However, it's still a work in progress, so I would appreciate your input and suggestion. The paper is to focus on citizenship rights. Okay, citizenship rights and Gulf women, looking at the level of rights and responsibilities and freedoms and equality, I make an argument that women in the Gulf are considered second-class citizens and their rights, freedoms indicate clearly that there is no equality between them and men as citizens. I'll give you a quick overview of the Gulf states and will focus mainly on Qatari women. This will be a very short presentation given that I have only 15 minutes. You know, it's very short for a serious topic, and I'm sure that the 15 minutes won't do it any justice. Women in the Gulf have been, as citizens of their nations, benefiting immensely from the economic growth that had reflected positively on their access to education, health services, and employment. Education as the main driving force across all six states in the Gulf, making up more than 50% of the overall student body, with Qatar and UAE having the highest male-to-female university enrollment ratio worldwide. However, citizenship in the Gulf seems to be gendered, and therefore women are in some cases denied their constitutional rights. Certain biases and prejudices are entrenched in the political and legal systems that deny women their citizenship rights, depriving them from participating fully and fulfilling their responsibilities towards their countries. If we speak politically, women did gain the right to vote and run for office. They were elected and appointed as ministers, MPs. Even in other leadership positions, we do have judges in UAE, Bahrain, and Qatar. If we look at the economy, between 1980 and 2000, women's participation in the labor force doubled in Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Kuwait, and Bahrain. It nearly tripled in UAE and Oman. Kuwait has the highest percentage of working women. They make up 54% of the workforce. Yet the areas of injustices that women face are many and include underrepresentation in political and leadership positions, gender-based discrimination in the workplace. We can talk about pay gap between men and women, glass ceiling, unequal opportunities, gender segregation and women immobility because of the guardianship system or laws in some of the states. Violence against women, we can talk about marriage rape, domestic violence, forced marriages, child marriages, and honor killing. Restriction on passing their nationality to their children. think I skipped one, sorry. So we see here two dichotomous pictures. On one is the call for and claim for women empowerment in the Gulf states and the above injustices. And we wonder how women empowerment are manifested in these nations. Women empowerment is an established discourse in some of the states, but an emerging one in other states. Women empowerment through giving control to women to organize themselves and create a critical mass that speaks for them in one voice is a path to educating women about their rights and enabling and preparing them for multiple levels of participation, whether political, economic, or civic. Some of the women associations in the Gulf are created and led by the government, which you know, keeps a big control over them, like in Oman and UAE, and some are a result of grassroots women movements, like in Bahrain and Kuwait. Independent women associations are prohibited in some states, like Qatar, Oman, Saudi, and UAE, who have laws against the formation of civil society organizations. A main hurdle as well for women researchers and scholars when talking about Gulf women is lack of research and data on women and women issues in the Gulf. There are few on Gulf women and fewer on Qatari women in specific. Now, zooming in to the Qatari case, Qatari women are indeed enjoying a larger space of freedom than women in other neighboring countries. The last decade has witnessed educational, social, and economic changes, which collectively have led to redefining women's public roles and therefore negotiating gender roles within the Qatari society. However, rights are still to be institutionalized, and laws need to be changed, and in some cases created, to ensure women's equality on different levels. Qatar National Vision 2030 acknowledges women as equal participants in the making of the modern nation. It emphasizes their participation in enriching Qatar's economy within various roles and in different sectors, which reflects the increasing confidence, of course, in Qatari women's abilities and the importance of their participation. Women's intended roles are highlighted in the pillars upon which the vision is built, especially the human and social development pillars. Building capacity through empowering women is a main route to achieving the goal of having more women in leadership, assuming leadership positions, of course, and participating in economic and political decision making. The Qatar National Development Strategy 2011 to 2016 focuses also on women empowerment through social awareness and leadership programs, with a target to increasing the number of women in leadership positions by 30%. It also promises that by 2016, gender-sensitized legislation will be developed to encourage more women to take active roles in society, and a thorough review of gender equality in public sector employment will serve as a first step in removing existing social and cultural barriers, so they acknowledge it. I just need to make a point here. We're embarking on 2015, and we're nowhere close to that. Women's economic participation has been a main objective on the government agenda. The government promoted women employment in several interrelated stages. They opened up most positions for women, assigned sections for conservatives who wouldn't approve working in gender-mixed workplaces, and promoted certain working women as leading figures in their respective fields. The desegregation of the semi-governmental and the private sectors has also attracted Qatari women who wanted to be considered as equal competitors for leading positions. As more Qatari women are entering the job market, the demographics of workforce in Qatar are shifting. The shift assumes that the numbers of Qatari women are increasing and will continue to increase, given that Qataris make up a fraction of the workforce in Qatar, which is around 6%. Women are economically active and present more than a third of the men, and numbers indicate a steady growth. Statistics show that the labor force participation rate of Qatari women rose sharply from 27% in 2001 to 36% in 2009. Now, moving from domestic to economic partnership doesn't necessarily mean equality, nor does it imply equal opportunity and equal compensation, sorry. For Qatari women, the increase in number of women in the workforce or in the workplace implies that the workplace has been modified to embrace the growing number and that it has implemented mechanisms to absorb these numbers as well as protect them. Is this the case? Well, to better answer this question, we need to look into the status of Qatari women in leadership positions and discrimination against women in the workplace. Women in leadership position, women participation in Qatar, Qatari workforce in general in the past decade or so has opened up many discussions about women's capabilities and has led to negotiating the traditional gender roles, as well as the cultural perception of women working roles, especially in decision-making positions. On the one hand, legislation has helped increase the number of working women by opening up new opportunities and new hopes to utilize these their degrees. On the other hand, there exists a social preference to specific fields that are considered more acceptable to women. Assuming leadership roles are the most controversial as it gives women the decision-making power over matters pertaining to the society as a whole and makes women, the woman, a public figure. Statistics show that over the past 10 years, the number of economically active Qatari women assuming leadership positions ranged from 2% to 4%. And in 2009, only 3% of economically active Qatari women had leadership posts. Cultural resistance towards women in leadership positions seems to prevail among both decision makers as well as the society. The gendered perception of leadership and the distrust in women's capability to lead even in the fields that have previously been culturally favored, like education and health, made the prospect of women venturing into the realms of politics and foreign affairs less realistic. So in the past, we only had 3 ministers, Qatari female ministers in the history of Qatar. The latest was Dr. Hassel Jaber, who is the 3rd female minister in the history of Qatar, the only female minister in the current cabinet that comprises 20 ministers. A glass ceiling exists, whether we like it or not, for Qatari women, as they still find it difficult to reach leadership positions. And when they do, they become easy targets for sexist criticism. For example, a patriarchal discourse is generated and circulated when one example of a woman leader fails to meet the society's expectations. And she is used as a reference to the failure of leading women in general, and we see it, in our newspapers and in social media that has been turned into a battlefield for bashing Qatari women. Gender discrimination against working women, even though the political will is to support advancement of women in the country, the patriarchal culture maintained by certain laws and regulations limits and undermines Qatari women's participation in the workforce. I'm trying to skip here I only have 5 minutes. Women are under social and cultural restrictions that men do not experience. Some are legal, such as guardianships and travel restrictions. A woman under 25 of age cannot travel without her guardian's permission, although a woman at that age is most probably a graduate, maybe with a master's degree, maybe married, maybe working. In terms of pay and compensation, according to Qatari labor law, Article 93, Part 9, women should be equally paid for performing the same job as men. This is not the fact. However, in reality, women don't get paid equally, and their benefits do not compare to men's. Women also face gender discrimination in the workplace, and there is a lack of laws protecting women from sexual harassment in the workplace. In fact, sexual harassment is a social taboo that we all know, that is never talked about or tackled in media. Lack of sexual harassment laws mirror the lack of laws in general to protect women from different forms of abuse, one of which is domestic violence. My last point would be citizenship and nationality right. Article 34 of Qatari Constitution states that men and women are equal in public rights and duties, yet Qatari women cannot pass on their nationality to their children like men. In conclusion, Qatar and other states need to renegotiate and reconsider the rigid traditional structure underlying their society's beliefs and practices that devalues women's public participation and emphasizes patriarchy. While change is indeed taking place, one may argue that change in women's status in Qatar doesn't correspond with the speed of change that has impacted other areas. Women issues seems to be the least important and still the most challenging in terms of policies and regulations. Women issues is a highly sensitive area, one that is connected to the religious and cultural structures and has a political dimension to it, given that the government, as progressive as it is still based on tribal allegiances. There is a need for a balance between top-down approach and empowering individual and grassroots movements. Women cannot function in vacuum and cannot be disconnected from the overall structures of this society. We cannot work in darkness as well. It's time to have independent women associations, especially in Qatar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Amal. Indeed, the theme is contentious, especially when it comes to discrimination against women in the Gulf, and considering them as second-class citizens, and having legislations in place to encourage women to participate in all levels of society. This is a very important issue, and we are tackling this issue in the GCC. Countries, we need to press ahead with such discussions. The second speaker will be Hatoon Ajwad, al-Fassi. She's an academician, and she specialized in the history of women in the Gulf. She has published her research extensively in Arabic and English. She obtained her master's degree from King Saud University and her doctorate in ancient history from the Middle East Department from Manchester University in England. The floor is yours, please. Thank you, Dr. Uhoud. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. Perhaps between a hard place and a rock, between the two academics, the two doctors. They will be talking about the matter from two different points of view, but I will be talking about the matter, and I think that this session pours into the same objectives, and there are plenty of common issues. Dr. Amal al-Malki has floated the idea of, she had touched upon the basic issues that led to the differences between men and women in the GCC countries and the discrimination against women. What I would like to touch upon here in my presentation is further themes, or perhaps the main, my main thesis. As a matter of fact, I would like to talk about this subject from the point of view that the youth are lacking. I think the youth were not present in this conference, despite the fact that we might say that the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies is credited for allocating a special session that we talk about women, a special session for women, and this is commendable. Why I'm talking about youngsters, because as you know, half of them are women, and the challenges thereby are more severe, because we do understand that this issue is intertwined with the religious and the politics. I had a summary in place, but we are still in the second boom, perhaps. But in 6 months, we will be perhaps talking about the demand of the women and the youth to have shares of the oil revenues since 2008 in order to exploit it. But I think the issues of participation, economic participation, and socio-political participation from the youth and the women are still not up to the standards. But we'd like to say that there are discrepancies between the Gulf states, and I'll be focusing on this point, i.e., talking about the difference between the GCC countries, especially the difference between the five Gulf countries and the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, because the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is the biggest amongst them. So the Saudi youth and the Saudi women do suffer, and this indeed is reflected in the percentages. If we have certain percentages of the participation of women in the Gulf, we think that women are not present in the leadership roles, and this will affect the quotas. And this will lead to the fact that says all the GCC countries suffer from this point. But we have to take into consideration the positive development in Saudi Arabia on the level of politics. In 2011, the King Abdullah has decreed for women to access the Shura Council, and we, in 2014, are witnessing indeed 30 women acceding to the Shura Council and the Municipality Council. It is envisaged that the women will participate in the municipality elections next year. I would like to answer some questions in my paper that relates to the contribution of women. I have a comparison, and as a matter of fact, I would like to talk about the challenges that this participation is witnessing since the cooperation stage where the GCC countries had went through in the last three or two decades, and the stage of unity that we long for soon, hopefully. When it comes to the challenges that resemble a stumbling block against the participation of youth women, they are to do with identity, unemployment, immigration. The conference in the last 2 days have tackled the issue of immigration and identity extensively, but unemployment was touched upon very swiftly. I think it is a daunting issue when it comes to women rather than men, especially the young women. When we talk about the advanced levels or perhaps the tertiary education graduates, but I would like to talk about our identity, albeit it was scrutinized in the last 2 days, but we haven't tackled the identity from the point of comparison between female and male, and preserving perhaps the identity or being rebellious against such identity between men and women. We can see that the burden that the burden of preserving the identity and its authenticity and to align modernity with traditionalism, as a matter of fact, this is emphasized in the male sector of the society, unlike the women's sector. For example, the males are put under scrutiny, and they always seek some people who represent them. But in the young sector, the youngsters have a different points of view. So a woman carry the burden with all its detail, so they are compelled to do certain things, unlike men, to a great extent. And we know that the identity has been manifested greatly
in the showdown with the others, or if it was under threat. But still, women in the Gulf,
actually, this is a message from the interpreter. The lady is talking in a very sporadic manner, so I'm just following what she's saying. Thank you. I would like to say that the contradiction might relate to the agenda. So a man being from the Gulf doesn't mean that he needs to put on the garment of the Gulf, but it has been reflected in his wife, because the abaya, or the garment of the woman that can, for example, be put, or perhaps the men can have shorts on, they can have a t-shirt. So this comparison is indeed shocking, and it doesn't represent, strangely, to preserve it indeed. So this theme, we've tackled this theme in great detail. I just wanted to talk about the political participation and the differences between the Gulf states. The main point that I touched upon in the beginning is the progress of the GCC countries on one level and having to strike a balance in other levels.
What I notice is the competition between the Gulf countries to try to excel or to be better than others on political levels. But this effort of competition sometimes is reflected through women positions between genders. So the point I was I wanted to refer to here is that the big challenge that the GCC countries are facing is that that they try to jump and to be compete between themselves. I'm repeating myself. I know. Excuse me, because my ideas are a bit confused. I'm waiting for this 5 minutes warning. The main idea is that women, that development, political development, or economic or social development that that can women can obtain and be benefit from in the Gulf states is reflected in Saudi Arabia one way or the other. But Saudi Arabia tries its best. I don't know how to say it in a diplomatic way. That there are some courtesies and some between different Arab Gulf countries when we speak, for example, about the mother or the major Arab country. Or so this country, that's to say Saudi Arabia, put some restrictions and conditions on the progress or development that women can enjoy in the Gulf states. The progress made by women on the Gulf states level might be embarrassing for the politicians in Saudi Arabia, and consequently they have either to give the Saudi women more rights and freedoms, although limited, or that they put pressure on the GCC countries to restrict their giving or granting rights to women. I'm here giving the example. Example of driving women driving cars, which is something very common nowadays. Kuwait, for example, Last year, the director, the head of traffic department police said that he will, he sent a letter to all his department that any Saudi woman should not be allowed to drive a car in Kuwait. This is something that is contradictory with all Kuwaiti and GCC countries' laws and regulations. But this reflects this courtesy business I was talking about between the countries on the but the women pay the price of that. And we see that there are some laws and regulations about regulating traveling to Saudi Arabia. This, the Emirates women are told not to drive cars in Saudi Arabia. This is not logical. She has an Emirate driving license, and consequently, but given the fact that this courtesy between different GCC countries leads to the fact that Saudi women cannot benefit from the benefits and the gains made by the other Gulf state women. Okay, time's over. You have 1 minute. I wanted just to show you by the PowerPoint another slide. I wanted to speak about the final or the last challenges. We have ministers in all the GCC countries except Saudi Arabia. The Gulf countries are no longer competing with Saudi Arabia. No, they're competing between themselves, Bahrain, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, but not with Saudi Arabia. We are still in the level of assistant or deputy minister. As for the elections, municipality elections, the coming ones, we want to see how far we can go compared to other GCC countries, but we're hoping, saying, inshallah, we will achieve something. As for the main challenges that we have, this political courtesy, and then this gender gap that is that has reached. I lost my slide. Saudi Arabia was in the position of 130 on the list no more than 135 countries. Even all the GCC countries as a whole, given the fact what I said, are only at the bottom of the list. I leave you with this page of about the challenges, and then I'll take my regain my seat. You can see the courtesies, the discrimination against women, the unilateral interpretation of Islamic Sharia in the different levels in the Gulf states, participation in work and education and labor force. We are the weakest or lowest in the world. And finally, the weakness of the legislations for protection of women in Saudi Arabia and in the Gulf in general. This is something that applies to all Gulf countries. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hatoon. In fact, the issues that the doctor has raised are very deep and require a conference for their own. She spoke about economic and political participation of women and youth in the Gulf countries, and that the issues related to youth are being exaggerated with women. And there is also problems with women in political and economic aspects. And she also spoke about identity, unemployment, immigration, especially the conflict between authenticity and tradition.
والله ما حكت شيء عن هذول.
لا. And she also said there are different levels of rights for women in the GCC countries, especially about in encouraging women by the government. And when changes are made by the government, this will be faster than the changes made from the grassroots. But the grassroots change will be even stronger. So we need a sort of balance between fast changes and granting rights of women in a fast way, in a such a way that these rights remain there despite the changes of governments and politicians. Our next speaker, third, I'll not say the last, Dr. Fawziyya Abu Khalid. She is professor of political sociology in King's Road University, and she is a writer of articles, and she's also a poet and a pioneer in Saudi Arabia. She has many publications in Arabic and English languages. She obtained her PhD in about women from Salford, Manchester University, Britain. Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of God, most merciful. I begin with a citation from the Quran that people are doing themselves injustice, not God. So I was speaking about the Saudi case, about the effect of petroleum on women. This might be a simplistic title, because it is not common to relate to the effect of petroleum on women, but there's also some other issues, such as giving the humanitarian aspect to petroleum, and even more that we'll speak about women and petroleum, because usually the general idea is that petroleum is like war, something only for males. But this strange title is only an introduction to discuss the issues of relation of women and petroleum, the relation of this with the political and women issues. Because I think we cannot speak about women and petroleum outside the political context in Saudi Arabia or on the Gulf states. The paper speaks about and raises many questions. I will not read them out, all of them, but I will. But in summary, and I hope that I think it's a pity that we work on a paper for 2 months, then we are given only 10 or 15 minutes to present it. Anyhow, this. Paper is methodology is a critical approach based on the thesis of Reitmans and Marcus, and also enlightened by the new writings of the postmodernism, especially Muslim and Arab women writers. I have made a field research of 150 units, let's say interviews, and I also did what focus groups. I took 15 women from different age groups, and I can say that this sample is an elite one, because I took the sample only from the female students, from students and teachers of King Fahd University, to ask them what is the influence or effects of petroleum on women. On my other paper, I did something that is experimental, but I know how accurate it is, that I have on the WhatsApp 15 groups, from New Media for the Youth to another group, Yummy Mommy, to a group that consider themselves the liberals and or others are enlightened Muslims. So I presented questions to these 15 groups, and that I analyzed their answers. I have here some definitions of the main terminology used in my research. What is the meant by rental state? Because Saudi Arabia does a rental state, that they depend on the rent that are selling their raw merchandise, that's petroleum, which is not being used to produce an economic national basis. And I have also defined what are the social forces which are different between the youth, the professionals, and I have considered the woman as part of the social forces who can also interact and give, whether as activists or if they are idle. I also defined what is feminine. That's to say, I said by feminine, that women are enabled to have a very equal life in the society. And as for the results achieved, which are the statistical results, there are the arguments that I have based my research on, or the points of arguments. The new argument point that I'm presenting in the paper says that if women had anything from the petrol, we would have seen better usage of this petroleum, and maybe would have more peaceful eras and less wars, and we'd have developed love weapons and would have decreased our imports of weapons because women are the most affected by wars. The other point of view is that despite the fact that petroleum was used to build the infrastructure, the new modern states and the Gulf states, but if it wasn't for the petrol, one couldn't have created the modern state on a unilateral political and religious basis, and this has put all the Arab and the Gulf states, including Saudi Arabia, of course, to give them the appearance of a political modern states, and they have been able to use technology and have construction, but at the same time they preserved the structure of the social and political internal structures and the force relations and balances that were existing before the appearance of the petroleum. And this has put the women on a marginal state, especially in the political power. As my colleagues said, Dr. Amal and Dr. Hatoon, that women's presence in decision-making positions is very rare. And the other thing I'm saying here, that petroleum has been utilized in a very selective way, in a way that improved the standards of living in the Gulf states, and especially Saudi Arabia. But at the same time, it has hindered the civil development of the societies in the Gulf and the creation of civil institutions because of everybody is based and depends on this government. And this has changed the society from being subjects to be citizens. In all cases, women are still marginalized because women are being looked upon as part of the subject and not people. And this has created a sort of feeling that women are wishful and look forward, especially in Saudi Arabia, that look forward that they can beg for their rights, not call for their rights or demand them. That's why what's given to them, what's given to the woman by the states is something necessary, but what's held from them is normal because they are subjects no more. The other point that I'm discussing in my paper is that that this situation has mixed the priorities of women demands, for example, which in driving cars has now given priority and given more importance than recognition of the citizenship and qualification of women, Saudi women. I think so far with different, and that applies to Arab other, she is not master of herself. She always has a guardian that she, and we always say that my guardian does not know my situation better than me. For example, a woman cannot get married unless she is approved by her father or by someone else. While as a religion gives us the right not to be have guardians. I also say that in education level in Saudi Arabia, we have achieved something good because the education of girls have been improved and they are, the universities are full of female students. But nevertheless, education has not changed the culture of women and the women see themselves. Because the education curriculum encourages them to do so. And we find so far that in scholarships, when I was studying in the scholarship, there was very little number of women outside being sent to scholarships abroad, while as now the number has increased. But there are so many obstacles that she must have someone, the guardian, with her. The other point of discussion is I'm being threatened by the chairperson. One of the negative aspects of the influence of petroleum on women is this very bad effects of the petroleum rent that has encouraged some extremist movements such as the Awakening Movement and other movements that we see nowadays. This has made of women a political card, whether for the politicians or the Islamic, political Islam or the old veterans. The eighth point is that the Gulf women or the Saudi Arabs, whether they complain or not, have this obsession of fear. Once I met a number of journalists, American and advisors of the Congress, and they told me, what's this issue of, what is the most important thing for Saudi humans now? I told them that that was at the American invasion of Iraq. I said, what is important for us that there should be no wars in the region. What is important for us that the religion should not be a point of focus. He said, but you have other issues, you women in Saudi Arabia. I said, well, the main important thing, we want stability and change. And then, as for other issues for women, we will deal with that by ourselves. We don't need foreign forces to tell us what we need and what should be our demands. Finally, the point that is part of what Dr. Hatoon spoke about, which is about the perspective of women participation in political life. Here I see, after the sociological reading, especially of my field survey, I say that many of the people I asked, do you imagine life without petroleum? One of them said, no. We hope that very long life for our petroleum. Dr. Abdullah, the king had said long life for petroleum. And long live and high prices for petroleum. Let's always pray to God for the high prices of petroleum.
Women, as a matter of fact, because of the welfare of oil, they do not present a critical mass whereby they can call for change. There are some elite that work upon this issue, but this theme does not represent a concern whereby people want to change in order to pressurize the government to change their stances, or perhaps for the government to be confident for making such change. This is roughly what I wanted to say. Do we still have time, or is the time up? 2 minutes? Okay. I'll just stretch the 2 minutes like Hatoon did, perhaps. As a matter of fact, the conclusion relates to the fields where the oil plays a major role in. The first domain is obviously the economic impact of the oil on women. This has propelled women to delve into the labor market, albeit the opportunities are meager. The economic enhancement made women independent, and sometimes indeed she would represent the breadwinner of certain households. But the negative aspect is perhaps being greedy or being a slave to consumerism. And as a matter of fact, sometimes the women can be the breadwinner of the household, but when we look for women to make decisions, we'll think that making decision on a part of women is weak. The other point is to do with the political enhancement. This relates to allowing the women to be outside the political domain. When we had the oil, there was no development of the political structure, and consequently, men to a lesser extent and women to a greater extent still outside the circle of the political structure. There is also a socio-political domain which represents itself in postponing the hot women-related issues like citizenship and the representation of women in their own merits, and especially when it comes to the recent stages. When we wanted to change, then this change will be contained and it will be aborted. Lastly, there is the value-related impact. The oil, indeed, has changed the value of independence. Women became more independent to a certain extent. But still, having women working inside the house is something of the past. Those who bring maids, for example, I wanted to say a second wife, but it was a slip of the tongue. Anyway, another maid, this made the things go worse because the value of the family has been lessened in its nature. When it comes to the statistics, in my sample, we can see that I had posed a question. I had posed a question regarding the oil impact on women. 99% of the respondents said yes. Did oil help in empowering women? Yes, 80% said yes. And when it came to education, it indeed helped in educating women, but it didn't help to make women eligible to represent herself because she wouldn't have the administrative capabilities and the tools to make the decision. And this is a problem indeed. In our university, in where we wanted the accreditation, the head of the university came compelled to have his office in the women's section to say that he is on the top of the two parts. But faculty members women couldn't access such official such office. And as a matter of fact, after the 11th of September and the external pressures, indeed, women in Saudi Arabia were present at the political landscape and the media landscape, but it wasn't activated politically. I think that there are some demands. Actually, the time is up. You said lastly and lastly and lastly three times. So thank you, Dr. Hatoon. Dr. Fawziyya, sorry. As a matter of fact, Dr. Fawziyya's wonders made me think of a scenario. What if women were the rulers and the revenues of oil came to their pockets? If we close our eyes and imagine ourselves as rulers, then we can imagine what would take place in the GCC countries, the Middle East, and the world. I would like to salute one of my colleagues who were with me in the 80s in America, Mr. Hassan Al-Ghanim, His Excellency, and my brother Ahmed. I would like to salute you, all of you, who are participating in this session. Thank you. So this scenario, I think women and men do share such scenario. I think I'm a chairperson, but I would like to say a few words. One of the officials in the Sultanate of Oman talked about this matter. He said if 50% of the ministers were women, then corruption will be something of the past, and things will get better. I think that most people agree with such view, because women look at things differently, and the complementation between the two views, men and women, is very important for the society. We'll open the floor for questions and answers now, please. Dr. Rafia. I hope not to discriminate in my selection of the respondents. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. As a matter of fact, this platform is beautiful. Could you introduce yourself, please? Dr. Rafia Abitagbash from the United Arab Emirates. We are glad to see a platform in the Gulf countries that is purely made up of women. A week ago, 12 women from across the world were honored, and I was one of them, one nominee. They wanted to honor me because I pursued the issue of gender equality. I said, sorry, if there were any efforts to be exerted in the Gulf states, they ought to be poured into the men, not the women. Men ought to be up to the standards. You can see that there are disparities in the education. The women are far ahead from men. I'm not talking about quantity, but quality. I think women are doing far better than men. So where is the problem? I think there is nothing to do with legislations. I can't see any legislations that obstruct the movement of women. But there is a threadbare culture, and time will come, and it will change with resourcefulness rather than showdown. And consequently, when I thought of establishing a museum for women, the Women's Museum in Dubai, I actually was surprised vis-a-vis the status of women in their societies. When it comes to politics, women helped to stop the tribal showdown or the tribal conflict, and they helped in education whilst they were at home and never went out their houses. I think the presence of women in our society is genuine. It's nothing to do with numbers and having women being ministers. You can put the women anywhere and they will be innovative and creative. So the issue is
as follows. We cannot follow the Western agenda when it comes to empowerment in their own lexicons and in their own terminology. I used to recite the Quran when I was a youngster, and I went to the West and I got my PhD. The West didn't help me. My family supported me, and I don't want to dwell on it, but I would like to thank you for your contribution. Thank you. If you could introduce yourself, please. Thank you very much. My name is Mohammed Muhyiddin. I am a sociologist. I'm the head of the research center at the Doha Institute for Families. I have a number of observations, but I try to pinpoint some common points. There are four issues that relate to the methodology that you have used in your studies, and there is a main problem in the methodology. It relates to the samples that we choose. Most of the studies conducted in the Arab world depended on the pupils or students because they are accessible. There is a problem in the methodology, not only in the Gulf countries, but in all the Arab world. We need to follow new mechanisms for scientific research in order to get to having policies. The policies depend on analyzing the statistics and the data in an advanced manner that leads to generic outcomes. The other point that relates to the policies, up to this moment in the Arab world, we haven't witnessed accurate analysis of the stakeholders and the social forces that stand behind the policy making. The constitutional base is not a biased one. It reflects the society in a certain state. We need to understand the nature of such forces and how a certain force can lobby in this manner or another, and how we can strike a balance in this matter. This is very important in understanding the reality of women in our world. There's another point. There is a claim, a supposed claim, that relates to the link between liberation of women and education. Albeit, we ought to understand this from a generic point of view. I actually loathe the celibacy or spinsterhood. These words, I can say delayed marriage. The delayed marriage in our societies and the aversion, the voluntary aversion of some women who have a great status in their work vis-a-vis marriage and the relationship with men and so on and so forth. This idea or matter ought to be understood, because education, when it comes to the traditional view, might make women more attractive when it comes to marriage, and indeed, the competition is fierce. So indeed, we need to understand this matter in a generic manner. I have further observations, but I'll stop here. Talking about this matter can go forever, but I hope that you will be brief. Yes, please. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Aisha. I'm a journalist. Thank you very much for the papers. I thought that the papers looked through the symptoms. I didn't look through the symptoms, and we couldn't. If we could understand the diagnosis, then we could treat the disease. I would like to say that you have alluded briefly to the religious discourse. As an Arab woman, not only in the GCC countries, the religious discourse has contributed greatly to the women's status currently. It did not float in the society. An independent sample of women is
specific identity away from the daughter stereotype or the married woman stereotype or the housewife stereotype. And that's why our society have not superseded such dilemma whereby women can be independent and play a major role in the public sphere. Dr. Hatoon has talked about the unilateral interpretation of religion. I just want to ponder on this matter in order to understand to what extent the religious discourse can indeed, because it is credible and people resort to it, how can we delve into it and plumb the depth of it in order to understand the samples of the society whereby they can participate without any fear and they can be indeed normalized and not outlandish, because some people say that these samples are imported. Thank you. Yes, please.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Maysa Al-Khawaja from the King Saud University from Riyadh. Thank you for your papers. I would like to wonder or perhaps talk about the following. When we talk about change and with all the statistics and the manhood's kind of discourse, I would like to talk about the resistance of women vis-a-vis change. When women conform to the mainstream discourse and the attitude that says that women are good and they are served and my guardian is has a better idea about my interest, and the women indeed themselves become the guardian of the mainstream and they do not resist, or indeed they resist the change. That means women themselves are resembling the stumbling block for change, and they do not understand their own duties. I disagree with the gentleman. The matter has nothing to do with educating women, but what is the education all about? The ideas of guardianship, the unilateral interpretation of religion that supports the guardianship system and so on and so forth. We need to revisit the education system and we need to raise the awareness amongst women as well. Thank you.
I'm Sharaf from the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies. As a matter of fact, I would like to thank the ladies who had suspended papers, and they talked about the status of women in the Gulf. Undoubtedly, the idea of empowerment and equality and representation, not only on the level of the GCC countries, but in the Arab world, we still suffer greatly in such domains. And within this context, I need to allude to the fact that working theoretically is not enough. Working in the hypothesis and in the theories and the theoretical demands does not suffice, is not enough to gain the rights and to revive the status of women. My question is to the ladies, and I wish that Dr. Hatoon would listen to this question. To transform the theory into practice. That's my question. How could we transform the theory into practice? How can we have associations and organizations that support the women and feminism-related associations in order to raise the awareness amongst women vis-a-vis their rights and the political representation and their active participation in society and so on and so forth. The ideas that relate to gender equality as well. And consequently, to contribute to raising the awareness of the society at large, as one of the ladies said, we need to raise the awareness of men vis-a-vis the importance of the status of women and to work together in order to get to the objective of empowering women and being equal to men and participating in all levels. So my question is, what are the main procedures in the GCC countries? I just wanted to hear about organizations and
movements, and what are the tools that they utilize to support the women? Thank you. Dr. Khalid. خالد الحروب عمل في جامعة قطر. دكتور فوزية أبو خالد, indeed she spoke splendidly about the oil and the relationship thereby to women. I want to strike a comparison between the outcomes of your paper and the status of women before the 40s, indeed in the 30s. And there are a number of studies that allude to the fact that the status of women before the oil boom was better than after the oil boom. Women used to work, women used to be more sociable, and men used to go hunting. They used to go pearl hunting for 2 or 3 months, and women used to be housewives and used to be workers, used to be sociable, used to be merchants, as if oil was a curse on women rather than being a boom. Last question, please. I wanted to be here in order to ask one question that I was thinking about for 40 years. Why women don't drive cars in Saudi Arabia? I haven't had an answer. Why? Is there any interpretation, reasonable cause that makes this society or half of this society not being able to drive the car? And in the other GCC countries, women are allowed to drive a car. In Morocco, when I lived in Morocco, women drive motorcycles. What is the secret of such ban? Why? Have you got an answer, a reasonable answer? Is it to do with education, or is it to do with awareness? Do we have a text, a religious text, that says this is prohibited for women to drive a car? When can Saudi women drive cars in Saudi Arabia? When they drive a car in Saudi Arabia, I would say that there is a right that was given to half of the society in this kingdom, despite the fact that I follow splendid writings from Saudi writers 20 years ago, and this cannot be conformed to what we witness. Have you asked this question 40 years ago, or is it the first time you're asking this question? Perhaps further questions, yes? We've got 2 minutes for further questions. Assalamu alaikum. Sawsan Kilani. I'm a human development trainer. I'm very happy to talk about this matter. We were supposed to talk about development and women. In the human development domain in Qatar, we meet excellent women, but indeed sometimes women lack confidence, and as they say, they resemble the candle that is lit and melts for the sake of others. There's a problem when it comes to assessing women by women. And I think that the oil and the wealth in this land, I think, had a negative impact on the majority of women. Most of women, because their pockets are deep, they indeed become complacent to the extent that they do not want to read any books or lift any book to read. I think there is a disaster. And yesterday, people talked about the education. The problem is
nothing to do with the numbers and who goes to the schools. The issue is to do with the concept of the education itself, because we are suffering, we're both suffering, men and women. Most importantly, women need to take on the initiative, and this summons the necessity of human development. Hamas Labiq from Bahrain. I would like to give you some numbers. Yesterday, we had an appointment for a woman in Bahrain because we have elections. Today, we have one minister, nine in the Shura Council, and three in the parliament, and three in the municipality. And this is an update, some numbers. How did we get to this number? In 2002, we had none. This was related to concerted efforts, not from the top of the pyramid, but from the civil societies, because we had some programs in place that targeted women and men. So we need to revive the society at large, not only the women, because if the men are revived, then they will revive the women. There's also the convention of the CEDA, and we had programs that conform to such a convention. I think that we need to focus also on the civil society to start from the grassroots, as Dr. Uhoud said. We need to emphasize this matter, and not only being benevolent or being also charitable. I am a woman. I am honored to be from Bahrain because indeed men have confidence in us. Our colleague, my father, my brother, and my mentor and my teacher. I would like to salute the men as well in this regard.
Fahd,
I'm a researcher. I would like to focus on a very important issue, i.e. this theme is very old. Arabs before Islam used to treat women unjustly. What I would like to say is that some of the religious texts, or the interpretation of some texts, are more ominous than what the Arab did before Islam. And this is very important. Every nation has a creed. This creed has been interpreted, and these emanate from a creed or aqidah. That's why we need to look through the inherent creed rather than the branches and the ramifications. How do we look for women? I would like to give you an example. I said that in some of our curricula, some people say that women cannot assume certain posts. I said in the Arab world, for example, since the World War II, men had the upper hand. And what took place in the Arab world, you can see a decline, catastrophes, disasters, wars. Who were the causes? The causes were men, leaders. We cannot turn a blind eye to this. The head of Malawi, she was a female, and she sold the presidential airplane to pay for feeding her populace. I would like to conclude by saying, I indeed commend what you said, but I would like to say that the scholars who adopt the moderate view that conforms to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and the Prophet's traditions, and since there's the story of Ummu Salama and Aisha, when they were at the head, or she was at the head of one of the armies, I would like to say, sisters, that these nowadays scholars have been subject to a vicious war from those who deal with the text
in a different matter and interpret it in a different manner. This, from my own point, is the diagnosis of the problem, and we ask the Almighty to help us in order to put things into perspective and to resort to the Prophet's traditions. And thank you very much indeed for your listening. Thank you, Chairperson.
Assalamu alaikum. Journalists from Turkey, where the President Erdogan recently said that women are not equal to men, it's against the nature. Just to inform you ladies, if you ever happen to come to Turkey, keep this in mind. My question is for Dr. Amal al-Malki. You started a campaign on Twitter, if I'm not wrong, a half Qatari campaign. I was wondering, half Qatari women are facing more discrimination than 100% Qatari women, let's say, or it's a human rights issue more than, like, rather than a woman rights issue. Thank you.
One last question, yes? As for switching Arabic and English, sir.
May God's peace and blessings be upon you. Fatma Al Khater, Cabinet of Ministers. We are all aware that the Qatari woman has reached senior positions at all levels simply by virtue of the wise and prudent leadership as envisaged in the national strategy. 2030. One of the programs is to achieve equilibrium or balance between women and the work market. And that's why the role of women was not disregarded, whether in the workforce or as one of the reform sponsors. 30% of women in Qatar have occupied senior positions at various development sectors. However, there is a challenge facing this factor of empowerment to Qatari women. We are ushering into another phase where Qatari women is competing, and the challenge with competition with men in a male-dominated society. Where women outperform men, women face a true dilemma. It is being confronted and fought against rather than being supported and encouraged by her fellow men. However, by the prudent vision and leadership of this country, we are certain that these challenges will be overcome. We wish the same to be addressed and also answer whether this can be achieved through women's society or human women advocate, where women could have their say. It is a true dilemma facing certain women at work level, at the work level. We have 13 minutes. We started late. I will give 4 minutes each to comment and provide answers. We start with Dr. Amal.
Okay, نبتدي بآخر سؤال. The Turkish journalist. Yes, I started the campaign. I'm half Qatari and let me just emphasize that a woman issue is a human issue, regardless, right? half Qataris are both men and women, and it is a social issue because it covers half Qataris from both sides, those who belong to a father, a Qatari father, and a non-Qatari mother who faces some prejudices, mostly cultural and social prejudices, and at the same time put them on the same footing with half Qataris whose mothers are Qataris and their fathers aren't Qataris, are not nationals, and are deprived of the citizenship. So it's a more of a citizenship right that they're deprived of. And there is another portion that I haven't really focused on, but will very soon, and those are some of the half Qataris from Qatari fathers who are not legitimate sons or daughters, result of maybe marriages or outside marriages and live in the West. So I think it's a human issue, it's not a woman's issue. Tapping very quickly on مقاومه المراه للتغيير مالي present in English, patriarchy is a mental mode. It's so entrenched in our culture. Women are products of this culture. للأسف عندنا المرأة, she thinks that she has to play two dichotomous roles, empower women, empower their daughters, but at the same time carry the culture and transfer it as it is to the younger generation. You cannot do both. Yeah, this is my five cents. كيف تقيم المرأة نفسها? I would say a woman should actually look at it from this perspective. I should be the best human in the field, not the best woman in the field.
يمكن دكتور أمل إذا تقدري تتكلمي عن أعتقد كان في سؤال عن الحركات النسائية يمكن في قطر.
There is no such thing in Qatar. يعني correct me if I'm wrong. We don't have any women associations in Qatar. كان في the Supreme Council of Family Affairs وكان تابع للدولة. There are no independent women associations in Qatar, which tells you something. يعني but there is nothing to say here.
Thank you for raising these questions and comments. I will comment on the bilateral interpretation of Sharia. The unilateral interpretation of Sharia will reflect on Dr. Sayed's comment on a woman's driver. I also commend Al-Ghafiz for mentioning the challenges facing the Muslim scholars who have moderate interpretation in their jurisprudence and juristic discretionary opinion. This has an implication on the GCC countries in general. The unilateral interpretation, I mean, adopting one doctrine in interpreting all the stands and all the positions, handing down certain fatwas or discretionary juristic opinions as answer to new unprecedented incidents based on centuries-old interpretations. And we found women subjected to certain principle adopted or handed down by the single doctrine jurists. And the principle of sadd al-zara'a, or providing an excuse, an answer to an excuse, I believe it prohibits what is not prohibited. Just as a precautionary measures, they prohibit what is not prohibited to avoid criticism or avoid mishaps in future. For example, women driving car is not prohibited, yet they prohibit it as if a woman is going to drive a car to head towards a place to commit a sin or bad behavior. The issue of, I also agree with Dr. Aisha in her statement that Gulf countries, namely Saudi Arabia, is in need of pluralism in terms of interpretation, simply for the reason that it is the only exit to the crisis of the Saudi women and also the crisis of Saudi Arabia versus the whole Muslim world, where plural interpretation or pluralism in interpretation is adopted. It is true that there is light at the end of the tunnel, yet we regret to say that the unilateral approach or single doctrine approach in interpretation has a negative implication on the role embraced by women. Here I would like to briefly indicate to the backwardness the Gulf countries are suffering, namely the Supreme Council of Women, which in Qatar, which was an answer to women's demand to have an authority governing and regulating their affairs. Qatar was one of the pioneer countries. Regretfully, last year, this apparatus was scrapped and integrated with other departments and ministries. I believe this is a step backward, built on a courtesy or a move backing down by women and their role, all the directions for different gains. The issue of women embracing the opposite view, I believe it has a lot to do with the way they were raised. They had no other alternative. If they are seeking a position in a male-dominated society or have discriminatory approach towards intellectually unique women, this would be the case. Thank you for the updating on Bahrain and Qatar. The comments we heard today about Qatar and Bahrain reflects the state of competition between the GCC. They have nothing to compete with towards Saudi Arabia. And I thank God this competition is healthy and positive. With respect to the women movement in the Arab world and your question, women on the ground and what they are doing, let's be clear that field work in Saudi Arabia is not available. It's not for the absence of active, proactive women, yet theoretically, no NGO, independent NGO, can be established. Only charitable organizations are allowed, as our fellow colleague from Bahrain spoke about. These are the only permitted societies. In Gulf countries vary and have differences about women's role on the ground or on the field. It is very advanced in Bahrain and Kuwait, yet there are certain legal restrictions and regulations in Qatar. There are certain societies, yet they do not enjoy civil independence. Women in Saudi Arabia are active, proactive, and they are, if you will, creative in finding methods expressive of their demands. The writing by myself and Dr. Fawziyya is part of the only means of movement. Youth, men and women, are dashing all the former taboos by all their creative methodologies.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, Hatoon has shot all the foxes, I think. I would like just to give you an example about the procedures. Hatoon al-Fassi, 20 years ago, she had launched an initiative with Dr. Aisha Abu Jadail and some of us ladies. She had an initiative whereby we can meet monthly on a regular basis. We can utilize such a platform to talk
to each other. And I think the oil has played a major role in distorting some of the facets of the societies. We don't have NGOs. The NGOs are being organized under the umbrella of the government, or perhaps the literary clubs or the charities. And the charities in this regard are infiltrated with some people who are enlightened, and they sometimes punch above their weight to raise the awareness amongst women. But the current demand is to do with the following. If we have movements and change and agitation, I think the women ought to be part and parcel of the change rather than being subordinate. The states ought to understand that this falls into their interests for women to be robust and active, because the states will be harm if women do not participate. The other point is to do with Dr. Khalid Haroub. He posed the question. It is important, especially when it comes to the history. 20 years ago, I had a study in place, and it targeted Al-Asir, the south of Saudi Arabia, and I met with those farmers who used not to wear the abaya or the black cloak. The essential woman image was on a par with the Western women, and within the perception of the extremism from the appearance. It sounds like the fuller, the game or the puppet that was famous in Saudi Arabia. So women were decent. They used to wear decent clothes, and at the same time, they used to be farmers. Used to be work with the men. As a matter of fact, we had witnessed a coup vis-a-vis some of the positivities that we had witnessed in the past. So surely, we need to revive the positive aspect in a way that conforms to our society. There's also another point. Dr. Hatoon has answered the car driving question. But I think to a certain extent, currently, especially when a number of women had launched campaigns against such ban, I think it is a bargaining chip whereby the government play use in order to think that the women have been taken care of by the government. And the other point is to do with Dr. Al-Ghafira. I commend his intervention. We need to follow a multifaceted interpretation of the religious text. And the last point that I would have said, but I would say it now. I think the thing that relates to the codifying of legislations, the legislations were not affected greatly. So the woman was away from the legislations. And thank you. Peace be upon you. Assalamu alaikum. Just a last word to comment on the change. I think two girls or two Saudi ladies were imprisoned. They wanted to drive a car. They attempted to drive a car, and they were imprisoned, and charges were not pressed against them. This is just an example of the women-related campaign whereby some women are innovative in this regard. A woman drove without a chaperone, and she got to the border, and then she was imprisoned. In conclusion, I would like to thank the ladies. I would like to thank you for your interaction. Dr. Fawziyya thanks her daughter, Tufool, for helping her in presenting her presentation. We wish that this center will allocate sessions for women regularly. And thank you very much.